Thank you for watching the World Community Magazine's Hour of Power Live on Facebook with your hosts Edward McQueen and April Garner.
Welcome to Live Alabama News.
Tonight we're going to be interviewing one of the eyewitnesses of the 16th Street Church bombing, where four precious lives were lost and over 20 others were injured in a bombing that was done by hate-filled individuals. So, Samaya, we're here this evening, and I want to thank you for interviewing with us. I know this is very tragic.
Well, it was scary to see a bombing happen. The people were scared too. They were running around grabbing their children and crying. And how it looked after, it was like it was completely destroyed. And people were angry and sad at the same time. So I hope that you'll show some of the pictures of the church afterwards.
So what do you think was the cause of this bombing?
I think the cause was hatred from white people towards black people. The bomb was placed beneath the church steps by whites who could have been affiliated with the KKK.
Thank you for interviewing with us this evening, Samaya. We are now going to show some of the photos.
You're welcome. Here are some of the pictures.
It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. I go to the movie and I go downtown. Somebody keep telling me, don't.
This is Veronica D. Muhammad.
And this is Karima Mia Muhammad.
Signing off from Live Alabama News. Have a good evening.
The lesson in this is that we must secure our churches and mosques and other religious houses to prevent things like this from happening. So we must protect ourselves. Along with the four precious lives being lost in Alabama, it's also like the nine precious lives that were lost by a wicked intruder at Mother Emanuel. The lesson is, we must protect ourselves and do for ourselves to prevent things like this from happening.
Good evening.
I gotta find that Sister Samaya, man. We gotta find her.
Nine years old.
Yeah, we'll be talking to her in a little bit. But we want to welcome everyone to the World Community Magazine Live. We are here tonight with special guest, Mrs. Marjorie McIver, the icon and the organizer of the Summer Reading Initiative for our Horry County and Georgetown County and Charleston County youth. I mean, we're everywhere.
Okay.
Impacting the youth. And we welcome all of you to the broadcast this evening. I'm your co-host, April Garner. And of course, our host, Brother Edward McQueen, is at the bottom of the screen. Look, you see what I did with that?
I was just about to say
it. It's at the bottom of the screen. We wanted to open up the show with one of the final projects submitted by one of the participants of the Summer Reading Initiative this year. As you know, our young people read two very powerful books. The Watsons Go to Birmingham, and they also read through the Green Book, one of the original copy, basically, and had summer reading activities and a culminating project. And then they also had a field trip at the end of the Summer Reading Initiative. And we have them here, some of them here, as special guests tonight to talk about their projects and to talk about what they learned through this literacy program, which is 3 years running. And
Of course,
we have Ms. McIver here to basically connect the dots for us and to answer questions as to why these particular books were chosen this summer. And there seems to be a progressive theme. The past couple of years, we've read books that related to the civil rights era, racial justice or injustice, if you want to call it that, and a few other themes. And these two books were definitely very poignant and appropriate for this Summer Reading Initiative. So welcome, Ms. McIver. How are you doing?
I'm doing fine. And as you saw and witnessed from Samaya's presentation and our introduction tonight, we see that connection between the incident that occurred in 1963 with the Birmingham bombing. And the book, The Watsons Go to Birmingham, was in memory of those four young persons who lost their lives. So it was because of that that we were able to look at some other connections. And we are connecting this also with the travels that will occur are occurring along the Gullah Geechee corridor. The history that is found along that corridor is one that we all probably have missed during our lifetime. We started with this book and the Green Book to show that life in the 1950s and 60s were very, very different than the life that we are experiencing today. And along this Gullah Geechee corridor, we decided to start this experience from Orangeburg, South Carolina. That was the first part of this Gullah Geechee tour. I'll call that as the first leg of our tours that we're going to have over time. And visiting that Orangeburg Museum and looking at South Carolina history, it took us way back into the past, into the 60s when civil rights movement was so, you know, active. We were so active in the movement. And as we go through the show and perhaps watch the slides that Mr. McQueen has put forth for us, then we'll see some of that history in action. In the Watsons Go to Birmingham, this family, which is really a typical family, left their hometown of Flint, Michigan, which is a very, very cold climate, to travel to Birmingham, Alabama. And throughout this experience, we were able to see how life was like during the 50s and 60s, how folks traveled during that time, and the lack of exposure to establishments like businesses, restaurants, restrooms that Blacks could not enter. And we are so reminded of the signs that we have seen throughout history, white only and colored only. And last night I got a chance to look, I think I might have watched it twice. I can't think of the name of it right now. But we were looking at a scene in the movie where one of the lead characters tore down the signs that had white only and Black only. The NASA Space Center, I'm sorry, I don't know why that escapes me right now. But that.
You're talking about Hidden Figures.
Hidden Figures, I'm sorry, Hidden Figures. Mm-hmm. And in that scene, it was so poignant in that one of the lead characters in the star in the show says, at NASA, we don't have white and colored. Mm-hmm. And that was a scene that reminded me of what was happening in some of these books that the young people were reading. And coupled with what they did in their research, they were able to interview some of the local resource persons that we have here. And we'll get into some of those names later on. I do know with the Gullah Geechee language, the interview that took place with Zenobia Harper, the interview with the, Pat Millett on Atlantic Beach. And we are hoping that on this second leg of this Gullah Geechee tour, we will go to Atlantic Beach. We had a meeting scheduled for the young people, but had to postpone it because of this past weekend's event. So Atlantic Beach and Myrtle Beach, the Myrtle Beach College School, we will go back into that and look at what changes that they have made in those settings as well. And then we'll go on into Georgetown and Williamsburg and then on to my hometown, Charleston, and see what sites that we have not visited or landmarks or markers that are there in those particular places that we need to have our young people knowing. And one of the focus of all of these research efforts is to try to get the young people to place this information in the schools. When they're asked to do projects, what better project than something that's directly related to your history and culture?
You're absolutely right. And because they don't all, of course, we know they're not being taught the true history and culture in the classrooms, and certainly not with the fervor and the kind of flavor that we would use in cultural enrichment programs such as this, and educational enrichment programs such as this. And so, Ms. Mack, why did you feel it was critical as well? I know it relates to the travels that are depicted in the Green Book and movie book, the actual literature and otherwise, but why do you think it was most important to introduce the Gullah Geechee culture and heritage at this time through the activities that were created for the youth?
Well, we know with the efforts that were brought forth by the involvement of Jim Clyburn in making this very historical corridor possible, and the hands of those that are involved in it, and making the connections between the historical sites and points that are found along the corridor. And I thought this was a good way of introducing the young people and their parents, because we had parents that went on the trip with us this past weekend as well. Mm-hmm. And you've got resource people like Marilyn Hemingway down in Georgetown. Mm-hmm. You have Veronica Davis, who's our very own homegrown, you know, Conwayite. You have our mayor, Barbara Blaine, who, because of Conway being situated the way it is and full of history, that she's a part of this effort as well. And Veronica Davis, of course, the Gullah Geechee historian as well. So it was important that we got a head start, and especially helping the resource persons who are going to be helping us to get the word out and to show, probably something like a show and tell, because those resource persons have agreed to help us in setting up tours in communities that are surrounding, you know, Horry, Georgetown, Williamsburg, and then Charleston County.
Mm-hmm. All right, so Brother Edward, of course, you and Sister Joella coordinated a trip for the participants and of not only the Summer Reading Initiative, but also the Summer Jobs Program. And so they were introduced to a museum in Orangeburg that probably a lot of people don't even know exists.
That's so too bad.
It really is. And so, but it's great that, you know, you created this opportunity for the young people to see it. And of course, the museum's curator, if you want to call him that, founder and CEO is Brother Cecil Williams, who we've had on the show before. Right. So why did you think it was important to create this particular experience to go along with what the youth experienced through the summer reading program as well?
So you want me to respond to that, right?
Yeah, I'm asking you. Yeah. Why'd you create that experience? Yeah.
Right. Well, look. First of all, I think it was a sad state to find out that that a museum was not frequented by a lot of our young people before. When Joel and I first went there, maybe a year ago, I believe. I mean, it took me back. It blew my mind. And I didn't go to state. She went to state, South Carolina mm-hmm. State College. And I never really got a full in-depth knowledge about the three youth who were murdered on the campus of South Carolina State. But when you enter that museum, you get the full history. I mean, the absolute full history and a lot of accompanying and supporting witnesses, and if not witnesses, you have some supporting efforts from some of the well-known South Carolinians, like Congressman Clyburn, Barack Sellers, okay, Bakari Sellers, and so forth, and a lot of unknown but heroic people that we don't know about until you reach that museum, until you get in there. Now, getting back to the trip, the children that we took, I think, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. McIver, but I think it was about 17, 18, right, that it ended up with, about 18 of them. Man, they were so excited. Now they want another trip. You know, I mean, that's, you don't find that too often, okay? Mm-hmm. Okay, and they want another trip. And the logistics that had taken place were carried out very, very well. I thought that it was well coordinated with some of the parents that were with us, and of course. And once we got there, the CEO, Mr. Williams, Cecil, he started off by giving or showing a lecture, and everybody was attentive, right? They were attentive to and listening to how he started things off. He gave them like a preview of what they're going to be seeing inside the museum, and just a good synopsis of the entire tour, the way I put it, for lack of a better word, I guess. But once that was over with, they just were freely roaming inside the museum, and they just want to have photos taken with them standing by mm-hmm. the famous things, for even Sam Cooke. Okay, they want. I mean, you're talking about somebody who was 14, 15, wanted to have photos taken by a Sam Cooke memorial that they had there, and of course the three youth who were murdered on South Carolina State, and that. So, and they wanted photos taken next to them. It just blew my mind. So, if that kind of interests still exists. You know, I don't mind doing that again. I mean, we don't have to make it a yearly thing. We can make it two or three times a year. You know, really. I mean,
you know, the beauty of that trip and that museum is it is South Carolina history.
Right.
South Carolina history. And he covered everything from the Board of Education, Briggs versus the Board of Education, the civil rights movement, the integration of those first schools, like Harvey Gantt going to Clemson, integrating that school, the school teachers who were displaced from their teaching jobs because they were members of the NAACP. And I mean, he just had a variety of pioneers, people like Thurgood Marshall, Septima Clark, and Modjeska Simpson, Matthew Perry, I.D. Quincy, all of those icons, you know, that are long gone. But it was amazing, you know, to me to witness all of that. But we do have the young people that are on that will share some of how they felt about that experience.
Exactly. So I'm going to pull up some photos, and we can just kind of, you know, there are plenty of photos, but I want to pull up some photos now to kind of go along with what you and Brother Edward were just talking about. And of course, we're going to show some of the summer job sites. And I don't know if they're all the sites, Brother Edward, you can expand on that, but yeah. Some of the sites and the youth that participated, and then we'll also show photos of the Orangeburg trip. And then we'll bring on the youth who are guests with us tonight to just kind of talk about their experience and what they witnessed on that trip, but also to give us their perspectives on the reading that they had over the summer, the two wonderful books that were part of their literacy enrichment program. So here we have, Brother Edward, you can explain as I go through who the partners were for this summer jobs, and then we'll go into the Orangeburg field trip.
Yeah, well, this is Palmetto Missionary Baptist Church, the summer camp, and we have partnered with them, but I believe for the past 6 or 7 years, I believe, the World Community Magazine Summer Jobs Program. And these are just some of the students. I just had to get that photo because they were so enthused about, you know, not just taking a photo, but they wanted people to know that they were part of the summer camp. Now, these were the supervisors. Now, we took some video of each of these summer employees that we furnished there. However, I don't think we have that today, but today is just a part one. Okay, today's just part. We're gonna continue with this later on. But here is this is the first time that McIver Graham Law Office they've partnered with us, and this was one of the most exciting experiences for two of our summer job employees. And here's the Bucksport Senior Center in Bucksport, South Carolina, and this is Brother Joshua Sherman. He's standing there between the Bucksport supervisor on his left and his grandmom. So in the James Frazier Community Center, this is, of course, peeping in the back is Miss Betty Goss. And she is some kind of supervisor down there. I'll tell you, she's doing a magnificent job. Really good job. And these are the two students that we supplied the McIver Graham Law Offices with. And we're going to show you with some video maybe one day. I don't know if it's capable of doing it today, but what they said and what Attorney Graham himself, who's right in the center, what he said. He gave a good narrative of what they represented, and they even visited courthouse. And here we have the Whittemore Park Middle School. There were two other students who were not able. They had to leave to go to college. But the other one is Brother Elijah Miller and his brother. And here's Camp Great at Conway High School. And on the left was the supervisor, Mr. Preston. He was supervising that. So, and Conway Recreation Center, of course, with Ashley Smith, and in the middle you have there Miss Janet Hopkins. Yeah, right. Yeah, and they had, of course, on the left there, you're going to see the young man who's going to be talking in a few minutes. And this is at Hope and Freedom Home Care. This is a wonderful, I mean, this is a great.
This was an excellent opportunity for them.
Yeah, right, mm-hmm. right. Yeah. And, and that's a great outfit, too, I tell you. They're providing some good service for home care, in home care. Here we, as part of the trip to Orangeburg, this is where the students, they visited South Carolina State College. And they were held. Yeah, well, okay, South Carolina State University. Sorry.
Yes.
Okay. And of course, as other part of the trip, that when they were eating, now they of course went to the restaurant, and the gentleman you saw standing, he owns a restaurant, and he gave a narrative of how he came about to get the restaurant. He's a native of Orangeburg, I believe. Correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. McIver, but he gave a good narrative to everybody, especially to the young people, of how.
His restaurant is D&B. I think it's Fish and Barbecue, and it is excellent.
Okay.
If you get to Orangeburg, please make sure you look him up.
Right, absolutely. And these are the most notables. Yeah, these were, I don't want to use the word caretakers, but they did an excellent job, I tell you, of kind of, for lack of a better word, chaperoning or making sure that the students were doing what they're supposed to be. And Mr. Cecil Williams is right in the center there, in the back. And here, some more. I don't know that lady on the left of him. Of course, on the right of him, I'm sorry. But on the left is Sister Elia Muhammad, and she's on the program today, this evening. And they post for that. And here are more photos of, these are summer job students by the World Community Magazine here. You see on the right of, on the left of them, they were posed, everybody wanted to pose in front of the three students who were massacred or murdered at South Carolina State University. And they got a good knowledge while they were there. I mean, because you had audiovisual instruments telling them what happened and support. And here, in fact, this was the initial start of the tour where he welcomed everybody and told them that, you know, they were special guests and to here's what we're going to be looking forward to seeing while you're here. Okay. And he gave a very good narrative back at South Carolina State University. And there's some very good tour guides there, but here is a front portion of the museum showing the students that involved. And there was one of the many photos that I took of that. Of course, on the right is Miss Betty Goss, okay? But right to the right of her. Okay, and the three students in question were here on the wall and, and appropriately so, they should be there for all the time. Okay. That's just a touch of the iceberg. Okay.
Yes. Yes.
A touch of the iceberg. I mean, when you get in there, there's a whole bunch more to see. So.
Well, those are wonderful photos, and you look like you had an amazing time. And I know that our youth guests tonight are anxious to talk about their experience. So I'm going to bring them all on the screen now. We have Samaya and Tariq Muhammad, Desmond Porterfield, and Elia Muhammad. How are you all this evening?
Good.
All right. Well, thank you all for being here. We really appreciate it. And you can turn on your mics because it's time for you to talk. So it's time, you know, you can unmute your mics as long as you don't have any noise in the background. First of all, I want to say thank you for being so engaged and attentive this summer and for participating in both of the programs. If you were in both, that's excellent. If you did the summer reading program, that's still a phenomenal pursuit, especially for the summer, because typically young people are out having a good time running around, going to movies, the beach, da da da. You all chose to spend a portion of your summer becoming more knowledgeable about our history. And it sounds like you had an amazing time doing so. So tell me about that experience. Who wants to share what it was like to read these two books and to complete the activities this summer. Looks like Tariq has his finger up. Tariq.
Yeah.
And Tariq. By the way, Miss Mack, you want to tell him a little bit about Tariq?
Yeah, Tariq, I thought his sister was the youngest who came to us on last year, and that's Amaya. She was 8, and now we have her younger brother, who is as sharp as they come.
Oh, my goodness.
And that's Mr. Tariq, and he is, how old are you, Tariq?
7.
What? That was quick.
How old?
7.
Oh, 7 years old.
Now, can you imagine? And then they talk about folks running with the big dogs. Well, Tariq ran with the big dogs, and he'll show you some good product before the show is over.
Exactly. Yeah. Who wants to answer my question? I think Tariq wants to answer my question. There seems to be some feedback. Make sure you don't have any other windows open on your computers, and that you're not listening to this on any other devices. Okay, I'll tell you what, why don't you all mute and I'll call on you as you raise your hand to answer, okay? All right, so Tariq, tell us about the Summer Reading Initiative.
Well, the museum shows what things were there and
the program itself.
Oh, the program itself means what I like about it is we get to see history of what happened when we weren't born, so that gives us a time to look at back of what we did, of what we've never seen.
Mm-hmm. And what was your favorite part of the Summer Reading Initiative? You did a number of activities and exercises, and then you also had to do a final project. What was your favorite part of all of it?
The final project.
Oh, I guess so, because he did a very nice final project. Do you mind if I show the audience what you did?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, all right. So I'm adding Tariq's project to the screen. Look at this, guys. He did a travel guide, Flint to Alabama. You want to explain what your project is all about?
It's what the Watsons go to Birmingham, what the Watson family drove through. The Watson family drove through Kentucky, which is where Muhammad Ali was raised and born and raised. In 1961, Bill Russell, Zach Sanders, and Sam Jones boycotted an exhibition game in Lexington, Kentucky, after being denied service at their hotel restaurant. The rest of the team chose to go ahead and play. The Watson family left Flint, Michigan, and they drove to Ohio and stayed for an hour. They left Ohio and drove through Kentucky. Then they drove through Nashville, Tennessee. Then they finally made it to Birmingham, Alabama.
All right. And so your travel guide pretty much depicts that travel path that they took, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, very good.
So April, can we just ask Tariq his age? Tariq, how old are you?
7.
Yeah, he said he's 7. Mm-hmm. Yeah, 7 years old and a very eloquent reader. You did a really good
job. Absolutely.
Yeah, exactly. And so Tariq did the travel guide. And of course, Desmond, you also did a travel guide type of project as well. Tell us a little bit about your experience with the summer reading and why you chose to do a travel guide, and then also talk a little bit about your experience at the museum.
Well, this summer reading program, it was fun for me. I liked it a lot, and it helped me look back on some things in the past history about where we came from, how we ended up here, and how it all started. And there's some things I don't even know that I knew from this summer. My project, I liked it. The final project was one of my favorites because I get to like go on maps and search up where there's history, museums, where they have some of our culture in there, Gullah Geechee culture. and it was great. The trip, now that one was great because when we got to the Orangeburg Museum and he started talking, and then he said Clarendon County, that surprised me because I'm from Clarendon County and I didn't know anything happened there. Mm. And it surprised me. And so as I got to walking around the museum and I saw some of our history, I was just like, wow, this is like amazing.
Blowing your mind.
I never knew so much about this.
Mm. What did you learn about Clarendon County? What happened there? Do you remember?
It was about segregated schools and where, let me see if I can remember this. I think it was the Briggs. No.
Yeah. Yeah.
Briggs versus Elliott. Right. Right. Petition. And that's all I can remember right now.
Yeah. Okay, well, that means that you have some research to do, as Ms. McIver would say.
That's right.
But I think it's amazing that you remember that much and that it intrigued you to the point of connecting the dots in your own history back to Clarendon County. So you seem to be a little bit of a history buff. It sounds like, you know, the travel fascinated you because your project included pictures and even directions on how people could get to these historic sites. And then, of course, the museum, like you said, it helped you to discover some things you didn't know before. So do you think you'd ever want to be a historian?
I want to. There's one thing I wanted to do was, and I remember when I was, there was the summer camp at GMOS. I remember, I think I told her that I want like to have like Black history mm-hmm. put into schools. So I want to try to do that when I grow up. That way other kids can learn about what we've done in case they don't go out for themselves.
Absolutely.
Well, you got a fight on your hands trying to get that back into school then. Okay.
He's up for it, yeah. So what about the Gullah Geechee piece? Can you tell us anything that you all learned about the Gullah Geechee piece through Ms. Pat and Ms. Zenobia?
Well, the Gullah Geechee piece, I know I heard G-Ma, she said some things about it, and on the when we were on Zoom meetings, they started talking about it, and I was trying to like catch up with them and say it, and it was a great experience to talk like them
to hear it. Yes,
and, mm-hmm. yes, man.
And do you know you're a Gullah Geechee too?
That's right.
Yes, man.
That's right. You may not have that authentic tongue like Ms. McIver, but we are all definitely Gullah Geechee. Exactly. Elia, tell us a little bit what your thoughts are about your experience.
I think it was very powerful, and it's something we all should know, especially in schools when we really don't hear much about our culture.
Yes. So what do you enjoy about the reading?
My favorite part about the reading was understanding some of the things our ancestors had to endure during the era and many things that affected our society for the better.
Mm-hmm. And how old are you, Elijah?
I'm 11. I'm turning 12 tomorrow.
Oh, okay. Well, happy pre-birthday. Very good. And Desmond, how old are you?
I'm 16.
16. So Miss McIver, Brother Edward, you have what, a 7-year-old. How old is Maya? Right. Is it 9?
She's 9, yeah.
9, 11 and turning 12, and 16. And they know and more about history than some of us who've been here 50 years alone.
That's right.
Isn't that something? Yeah. Absolutely amazing. Absolutely amazing. So as you think about the summer literacy and the field trip, how would you incorporate some of these summer experiences into your classwork this year? Yeah, school has already started for some of you. If you're in Horry County, I don't know about down in Charleston, but how will you incorporate what you know now into your lessons?
I would start by, when I'm in my history class, using some of the stuff I know to educate others and educate myself and know the difference between what they're telling us and what is right.
Woo, that's Woo. Powerful. Yeah, what about you, Des?
I would love to
it's all right,
teach
time.
Other people, go out. in each schools and teach them about our history in the past.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So basically, you're saying that all of you can be a part of the education process. And when you're talking about our history in schools, whether it's social studies or whatever it is, you have some knowledge now that you can incorporate into those discussions. So that's a wonderful thing. Yeah. All right. So let's see some more of the project. I'm going to bring up Wandering with the Watsons, which was one of the newsletters that was done by Jacob Platt. And Ms. McIver, you want to talk a little bit about this? And this is such an amazing project. First of all, it's very colorful and very easy to follow. And a lot of the youth for this program chose to do the travel guides, which I think was a good thing because it helped them to, first of all, it encouraged them to do and motivated them to do some research, but also to kind of put it into their own words and to use their creativity to come up with these travel guides that are similar to the Green Book. And this is the version of the Green Book that the youth use for their summer reading, just in case anybody's wondering which version was used.
Okay. And there's also a Green Book that has like four different years within that book, and it gives you a little bit more information. But this travel guide here that he used, you could see how he listed his information. Mm-hmm. Life during that time, 50s and 60s, the travel conditions that the people traveling had to experience. And also that on this particular trip with the Watson go to Birmingham, a lot of their time, according to this research newsletter, says a lot of times had to be spent in the car.
Mm-hmm.
And that was because if they got out, they had to be careful where they exited the car, in what city or what state, what places, what sites. Mm-hmm. They had to be real careful because they didn't know whether they were going to be injured or, you know,
they were in a sundown state or sundown city.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And they had to learn about the sundown cities where, you know, you had to leave those places before the sun went down.
Mm-hmm.
So the young people learned a lot about that. And one of the things that I'd like for us to go back to with Elijah did a couple of interviews, and one of them was with Miss Pat Mollett.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe she could share some of what happened during that interview.
Yes, ma'am. I interviewed Ms. Pat Mollett and also my grandmother, and they told me a lot about where places we couldn't go during that time in the 1950s and 60s. And only if you are a maid or cook, you can be in the places where many whites would go. So on oceans, you couldn't go to the beach. Only the Atlantic beach you could go to.
Mm. How does that make you feel, knowing that, you know, something is what we would say is simple and as open and as free as the beach, we couldn't go to the same beaches as white people? How did that make you feel?
It feels really strange that during that time, like many of my ancestors had to go through that, and it, I mean, I want to act for change and equality. That's how it really makes me feel.
Hmm. Well, that's a strong feeling to carry. It's a strong feeling to carry. It really is. So, well, I also want to share another project that was done by Malia Floyd, and she called it the Floyd Post. And it's getting into another part of Black history. It's the bombing at 16th Street Baptist Church. So Ms. Mack, you want to talk a little bit about Malia's project?
Okay, well, we know that the book, The Watsons Go to Birmingham, was in memory of the four young persons that were killed in the Birmingham bombing. And Malia so vividly shared with us what that looked like during the time. The church that they went to, these were the four young girls that were killed in the bombing. That was Addie Mae Collins, Denise McNair, Carol Robinson, and Cynthia Wesley. Now, we remember this occurred in 1963. The Sisters of Addie Mae Collins came to Charleston prior to COVID to share their stories with the Charleston community after the Emmanuel tragedy. And they shared what the life was like in the family. The oldest girl had, and who was 12 years old at the time, had to go to identify her sister's body. The officers took her down to the morgue to identify that body at 12 years old. And one of the interesting things that came out of that merging that we had in Charleston was that none of these young people got any kind of mental health counseling. They were just thrown out. Their families were sent back home without any kind of assistance. And it truly was a tragedy in more ways than one. And for these young people to have been exposed to that, you know, and the aftermath of it was just as horrific. And of course, Sarah, I believe it's Sarah, the sister Sarah, is blind in one eye to this very day.
How old is Malia, who completed this project?
Malia should be 11.
11. So, you know, I'm still in awe of the clarity and the creativity of these projects and the fact that these young people had to dig into the history to complete these projects. And at such a young age, I mean, you know, the depiction of, you know, what happened to them and the photos that were used, it really does strike a chord and a nerve if you are able to ever see these projects up close. Just, you know, this is the history that we're not always taught. And the summer reading program introduced them to, you know, this part of history that if, and I'm gonna put it into perspective for some of our audience members. It happened in, I think you mentioned 1963.
Yes.
If you are 59 years old, it is now 2022. 59, if you're 59, you were born in 63. So that's amazing.
Yeah.
That it was a short time ago, if you really think about it.
Yeah.
A short time ago.
So when Desmond talked about looking at the history class and introducing it through that way, your English class is one of the most viable, you know, options to use to introduce this, because in your English classes or your language arts classes, you're going to be given topics that you can choose. So when you choose a topic, choose one that will highlight and enhance what you've learned during these experiences. Not just in history, even in your art classes. You remember last year, April, we had the young lady that drew the picture of, give me the name.
Breonna Taylor.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful artwork.
Mm-hmm.
And then we had Eliah, I mean, who created a doll.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that was a part of her final project. So the art classes, any of your subject areas and your curriculum, you could incorporate this, because we were there.
Mm-hmm.
We were there in all aspects. And look at Mr. Cecil Williams. He's a photographer. He started out as wanting to be an architect, and he used even his architectural experiences to help create that museum. And the pictures that are there, a lot of them are pictures that he took, and he's got volumes of pictures in books that you could purchase. You could even go on Amazon, but it's best to purchase it from him.
Mm-hmm.
The cost is, it's more cost productive to get it from him.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
So the question I have for these young people, as we kind of come to the end of the show, I have a couple of questions. One, why do you think it's important to have summer enrichment activities like this, and especially to have a reading initiative? And also, what advice would you give to young people about what you've learned and why they should be a part of this? So let's start with Elia.
I think that the summer program really teaches you about the past and something that you can always use for the future. And you can put it into anything, and you always can learn something new in terms of what you would like to do in school or anything. My advice would be to learn, keep learning, never stop learning, because there's a lot of things that you may not know.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, this summer initiative is really powerful, and it'll teach you a lot.
Awesome.
Well, you got a powerful teacher over there.
I'm telling you. I'll sit in Elias' class any day.
In the day.
Mm-hmm, any day. All right, who wants to go next? Desmond, you're unmuted.
Okay. I will.
Mm-hmm.
An advice that I would give to anyone would be to never stop fighting for what you're fighting for. Never stop learning and never give up, because at the end of the day, you're going to succeed in anything. Just never give up. And that will probably be it.
Okay. And why do you think it's important for the youth to engage in a summer reading program like this?
To help them learn about their history and what's been going on, to help them overcome things, to help them learn more, and to help them achieve.
Mm-hmm. All right, great advice, great insight. What about you, Samaya and Tariq?
Mm-hmm. Okay, go ahead, Tariq.
Okay. I would give the advice is to, you should learn. If they're not learning, then you should learn about what your own people had to do before you was born, so you could see and compare to how it is today. Some of the same things are still happening, but they're under disguise. And if they're already learning about, they're already learning, I would tell them, good, keep learning.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Wow.
Brother Tariq, do you have any advice or anything that you'd like to add?
Well, I don't.
Why do you think it's important to be a part of a summer reading program like this?
Because there you can learn different all sorts of things, like what we were doing, but we about history and life for our people and other things.
May I ask Tariq a question? Tariq, was this the first time you read this book?
Why go to Birmingham? Is this the first time?
No.
Okay, when did you read the book the first time?
We read it as a family two times. We read it one time, and then we read it again.
And how old were you?
I was five.
All right.
Five. Whoa, 5 years old.
Right, man.
The fear is here on the screen.
Yeah, it's right here on the screen.
Yeah, it's right here. Go ahead, Brother Edward.
Yeah, let me tell you what I got from this, from these three, the four individuals that, I'm kind of overwhelmed now, but they are prime examples of what they said were prime examples of them saying that you need the past in order to know what your future, how to deal with the future.
Very good.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I think without concluding that themselves, I think that they've come to that conclusion themselves,
mm-hmm.
that the past was so important. The way they expressed themselves and they articulated the extractions of the book tells me that they understand now and they comprehended that there was just trouble in the past as us as Black Americans, you know, and what their ancestors, like Elias said, what our ancestors had to go through. And we need that to build on for the future.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well, I think you all did a phenomenal job, and we definitely want to thank all of you for participating and sticking with the program from start to finish, for creating such beautiful projects, and just for sharing your perspective on everything and all the insights and your experiences. This is going to stick with you forever. And I know that with the passion that Ms. McIver has, as long as you all are in school and willing to do it, there's always going to be something for you to read over the summer, yeah, and something for you to engage in. And now Brother Edward and Sister Joella have added this element of the field trips. I tell you, it's a great way to spend the summer, isn't it? It really is.
And look, at they got paid to do it too.
Hey, hold on.
The completion, yeah, of the project. Right, the young people have stipends coming to them as well.
Absolutely.
But one thing I'd like to say to April, thanking you and Edward and Joella. There were others too who were instrumental in helping this. And you have Miss April Brown.
Absolutely.
You have who helped, especially with the middle school pieces and the elementary school, the high school piece. And then we had Hanna McIver with the elementary school.
You better straighten up her name.
And Miss, we can't forget Miss Marlo Frazier.
Right.
Who is our technology guru in helping the kids to look at the researches that they could go through to make these newsletters, and somebody did a postcard, the travel journal, the travel guides. Miss Marlo Frazier walked them through all of that, and last year and the year before did a fantastic job in getting the kids introduced to newsletters and other publications and pictures that they could use in their publications.
Mm-hmm. Well,
I can't say enough about the parents and the adults who accompanied us on that trip. I just really can't say enough. They did more than their part. We even had Mr. Frazier, Marlo's. He wanted to come. I mean, he wanted to see what was going on.
And the mother-in-law.
And the mother-in-law. Wow. Right. So we definitely have to plan this again. Okay.
Yes. Yes. This is what it truly means to support our youth through the village, because the village did it. And Ms. McIver, thank you so much for creating such a wonderful enrichment program for these children and for including all of us in that. And I hope you all really enjoyed it. And it was a special treat, the inclusion of the field trip this year. And I know that there's some other things that are planned. You guys are going to go and tour Atlantic Beach, I believe. And there's some more coming. So, hey, it's not over just because the summer is just about over. And I hope that you all will continue to enjoy it. And so, Samaya, we showed your video clip at the very beginning of the broadcast because we wanted to open up with your video piece, which was excellent. You did a wonderful job, and it helped us to set the stage for what we were talking about today. So thank you very much for that. It is in our archives now. And so I hope you all really enjoyed the summer program. And to our viewing audience, thank you so much for watching. Brother Edward, I do have a commercial break before we sign off, and then you and I can kind of wrap up. You all are welcome to stick around. But again, thank you all so much. And we hope that you have a wonderful school year, okay?
April, can I give kudos out to South Carolina State University?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Ms. Demaya Richardson Sanders. I mean, just the spur of the moment was able to pull together those young honor students and leaders at South Carolina State University to help guide the tour that the young people went on. Excellent. So kudos to South Carolina State University and Demaya Richardson Sanders.
Awesome. Absolutely
really.
Excellent. Yeah, so we just want to thank you all. And Ms. Mack, have you already chosen a book for next year?
Listen,
next year.
that resource committee that we have.
Yes.
Zenobia and Pat and Marilyn and Veronica, they're going to help with this one.
Because okay.
we're going to travel this coast until we can't travel anymore.
Exactly. Wow.
All right.
That is absolutely awesome. The Gullah Geechee Trail. Yes.
Okay. I'd like to remind the that some of you who took the individual videos, like Brother Desmond himself, and that we took at your work sites, that we're going to gather them, and including a special video that was shown before this program began of Sister Samaya. We're going to compile all of them. We're going to have a good program. It may be in a building or something, or where we can all get to sit down, or maybe just virtual. But just want to remind you that we haven't forgotten about you, and those of you who are viewing, we took a lot of individual videos of yourself showing expression, your appreciation of having some employment to our audience. So that is to come. And just want to let you know that we haven't forgotten about it. So we will show it.
All right. Well, we're going to close out with our commercial break, and then Brother Edward will come back at the end to see if there are any more announcements. But to our special guest tonight, thank you so much for being with us. We really do appreciate it.
All right.
You're welcome.
All right. Y'all have a good one.
You too.
Okay. All right, Brother Erwin, you ready to wrap up the show?
Well, no, I'm not. I wish we could talk some more with all your illustrious guests we had tonight. And I'm so filled up with that. Just listen to them, okay?
Yeah.
I know. That just puts us on the road to doing other things. That's what that is.
Yeah. So it was absolutely great. As always, we enjoy it. This is it hits us kind of in the middle of the summer. It takes us to the end. And I think the kids really appreciate it. I mean, we could tell in the way they were able to speak about their experience, and they were, definitely very thoughtful in what they said. And I think it came from a very genuine place of learning more about themselves. It's one thing to say we have culture, but it's another thing to really understand our culture and to know our culture. So that was a wonderful thing. And I think partnerships like this are always a blessing to our community. So we have to continue to do that. We have to work together. And, the summer reading and the jobs program seems to always come together at
the right
point. Right point. Yeah.
We didn't say anything about the parents behind those children.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. They had, you can just tell by the way they are talking that the parents had an integral part. Okay. And so congratulations to them.
Mm-hmm.
And we applaud the parents very much for that product. I want to say a product, for lack of a better word. Okay.
I thoroughly enjoyed this evening, Brother Edward. And if God says so, we'll do it again next Tuesday, 7 p.m. with another special guest or two, or maybe just the two of us. Who knows? But we'll bring back another great show. And we want to thank all of our listeners and watchers for tuning in with us tonight.
Absolutely.
All right.
Godspeed.
Yes. Have a great rest of the week, everybody. And thank you for tuning in.
Thank you for watching the World Community Magazine's Hour of Power Live on Facebook with your host Edward McQueen and April Garner.